See? Okay. Welcome to Composerscape, and it's episode 19, and I have unilaterally and without any real justification decided that it's season 2, so we're going to be starting a brand new playlist.
That seems appropriate.
Because we took 2 weeks off.
That's right. Given our recent hiatus, a little vacation time, summer, things happening.
Lawns to mow.
That's right.
And now we got a heat wave here in Massachusetts, and it's miserable, and I'm very happy to be down in my nice, cool basement.
So you say that it's a heat wave in Massachusetts, which would probably be very comfortable compared to Kentucky and Tennessee.
Yeah, you probably got more humidity.
It is 95 out, though. Air conditioners are blowing. We don't have central air here. No one has central air except well-off people.
Right. Yeah.
So we got a lot in this one. We're going to talk about so much. There's so many things that, like, there were like several times and we've been so busy. It would be like, text you, Scott, and be like, this Eternal trailer, it dropped. We got to jump on and do a thing. And you're like, yeah. And then by the time it's the evening, we're both like, no. And then, the Shazam thing, which we're going to talk about that. Jupiter's Legacy came and gone.
Came and went.
Just like
yeah.
That. Yeah. I finally finished Invincible, and we're going to talk a bit about Army of Dead. It'll be spoiler-free because someone amongst the two of us have not seen it yet.
I have not yet to see it. That's right. I have not seen it yet. I tried to Yoda that sentence there for a minute. I hadn't seen it. I have not.
So well, that's the vacation. We forgot how to talk. Yeah. So we'll dive into all that and whatever else. I can't even predict the tangents, but they're coming for sure. Yep. So hold on to your hats. Mm-hmm. So we have this Eternals trailer. It dropped like 2 weeks ago, I think, in the middle of our hiatus. And this one looks great because we've been talking for a few episodes about how we were like not sure what to expect, and I think I'm even less sure, but it's just a very pretty trailer.
I have my theories about it, which we talked a little bit on a previous episode, just a little bit about some of the history and origins in the comics, and the little bit. I am no expert on the characters themselves. What I do know is that they're immortal protectors of the Earth. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the characters' names, it's kind of a spoiler for this aspect of it, but several mythologies were birthed from, you know, different cultures around the planet because of the actual characters, right? That these they've been around for, you know, 200,000 years or some ridiculous long time. And so I think, in looking through, and I've seen a couple other commentaries on this where they dissect trailers, which I'm often not one to do that, but they point out several scenes. If you watch it in slow motion, you see what appears to be different epochs, different time periods, the characters interacting in different, and so I feel like we might get an origin story / different character arcs over different time periods, and it's probably going to be kind of like a family drama with this.
I think this is going to, it's going to bring up the same question though that we had at the end of Zack Snyder's Justice League with Martian Manhunter. It's like, no, wait, you wait for after two alien invasions to decide to get involved. It's the exact same thing. It's like these people's like, well, after two alien invasions and one crazy robot, I think we might need to help out.
That's
now.
Right. Yeah. For them to not have shown up during the Infinity War and Endgame. Right. But who knows? Maybe that's a really good reason for that. Right. We have yet to see.
Well,
trailers don't tell you much. They just give you an idea, I think, visually.
Well, bad trailers do.
Well, good point.
But let's watch this one, speaking of. You want to?
Sure.
I'm going to hit the wrong button.
To make this larger.
The directors love that shot.
So I don't know if we're in
guess this is like ancient civilization here.
Yeah, possibly. And not sure if that's supposed to be a celestial ship.
Listener.
Maybe, yeah.
I guess that's...
I thought the Celestials were giants.
The Eternals were... Yeah, they are. And I mean, it was my understanding that the Eternals were created by the Celestials, but...
Ah.
That seems to give the impression that they showed up on a spaceship.
Yeah, maybe.
Watched. Who knows?
Unguided. I love that synthesizer music. Progress. Unseen them.
Throughout the years, we have never interfered. Until now.
Yeah.
Thank you for this.
Oh, you're welcome.
So now that Captain Rogers and Iron Man are both gone, who do you think's gonna lead the Avengers?
I could lead them.
Good stuff.
Yes.
So, someone cleverer than I pointed out the strangeness and sort of circuitousness that is Richard Madden and Kit Harington apparently having a part of the story arc is, you know, Kit Harington being a... I think the character he plays in this film is just a vanilla mortal, you know, just vanilla human.
He's playing the Black Knight.
That's right. Right. As a Dane Whitman. That's it. The Black Knight character, who is... He's human. He's not an Eternal, but having a fling, being romantically involved with Angelina Jolie's character, who's Athena, or just Thena, I think, mm-hmm. and who historically was a love interest for Richard Madden's Icarus, his character. And so you've got two of the Stark brothers in a love triangle with another character named... I'm sorry, not Athena. It's Circe,
right?
Which I think was played by... I'm gonna have to open up the IMDb page. I think it's
she was the one. Jim by Chan. The way, Angelina Jolie was narrating.
She's playing
right?
Athena. Voice-over. That's right. Is it Gemma? Is that how you pronounce it? Gemma Chan?
Playing the role of Circe. I heard of her before. I'm sure I've seen her in stuff, but I just can't remember what it was.
Anywho,
oh wait, she was in. Wasn't she in, she was in, Captain Marvel. She played one of the, Ronan's crew, I think.
Oh, yeah, Minerva. That's right.
Yeah.
Yep. Who was a long-time Captain Marvel villain. So that's interesting. So she's going to play a completely different role. She'll be the second person, at least in MCU, the third... If you you know, expand out to all movie studios, we had that conversation recently where you've got different actors who have played different Marvel Comics characters in different films.
Some of them played both DC and Marvel.
That's right.
I love that guy. What is his name? I can never pronounce it.
Ian. Yes. Talked about that show. Well,
so this is interesting. They are, in the DC universe, you have the old gods, which are like Zeus and Thor and all of those. Those are the old gods. And then you have the new gods, which are the Apocalyptians, most famously Darkseid.
Right.
But the Eternals seem like they're older than old gods. Like they're older than the Asgardians. So
right.
They're like the old, old gods. And all of these were created by Jack Kirby. So,
right. And I don't know that's so... And the interesting thing there is that to call them gods, I think, is more based on human mythology, right? I don't know if these are beings that ever claim to be gods,
right?
It's just...
Well, the Asgardians love to claim that.
Well, sure, sure. I was talking about the Eternals. I don't know. We'll see. Yeah. If I'm not mistaken, they're related to like their foil, right? Their sort of villains, I guess, if you want to call it that. The foil of the Eternals, at least in the comics, were the Deviants, which are, I think, their counterparts who went bad at some point. And if I'm not mistaken, I mean, Thanos is a Titan, right? But he was he's related to them in some way.
Well, I mean, you would think so, since Thanos is clearly, Thanos was like, we need our own dark side, so they made Thanos.
Right. Thanos, just looking at the, you know, Marvel Comics, you know, wiki, the Marvel Comics online, their database. Thanos is actually an Eternal in the comics, in the continuity. Some of Thanos' backstory has been explored in the Infinity War, right? Movies could dive into that, but based on the original story written by Jack Kirby, the Eternals tells the story of an ancient group of immortals who lived on Earth for thousands of years. The Celestials, right, were their creators. The Eternals created to battle the Deviants, who in the comics are their greatest enemies.
And they didn't show bad guys of any kind in the trailer, didn't seem like. It seems like,
yeah, it didn't seem like
they're saving that.
Yep. Something I know very little about, I don't claim to be an expert on the Eternals, but one of the Eternals appears to be a child. Even though,
yeah, I think that character's name is like Pixie or something like that.
Sprite? I thought it was Sprite.
Something. It's one of those mythological fairy kind creatures.
Right. But it seems kind of cruel, right? Be thousands of years old and trapped in the body of a 12-year-old.
The entire plot behind Interview with a Vampire.
That's exactly right, Anne Rice. Right. It eventually drives her crazy for good reason.
I love that scene,
yeah,
too.
I don't know. Whoever
You've
conceived
been a
of
naughty
that.
Girl.
It feels like an ill-conceived plot point, plot element. Well, definitely looking forward to that.
Yeah, they're going to run into the Shazam problem with that, aren't they? Unless this is a person that's like Tom Holland that's actually 25 but looks that age.
Right.
Because Shazam, they're like, we can't wait 5 years to film a sequel because the kids are going to grow up. And then it's just, it's going to get awkward when Billy becomes an adult, and why when he turns into, I mean, I guess it would just be Zachary Levy the whole time, or is Shazam literally a different person? Have they ever done the adult Billy in the comics, I wonder?
That is a great question. We'll table that for next one.
Yeah. But, so I'm pretty stoked for this.
What do we know about, I was going to look real November. Quick. At Eternals, what do we know about, is it Chloe Zhao? I'm probably butchering her last name.
Well, she just won Best Director in the Oscars.
That's right. Was that Nomadland?
Yeah, I want to say so. I didn't watch the Oscars this year. We actually got rid of regular TV. We finally were like, you know what, we use it to watch the Super Bowl and the Oscars, and it's just not worth the $8 a month. Because all we had were the regular channels. We didn't have any of the extended channels. So, yeah. It's Marvel's first Oscar-winning or nominated director for any of their movies.
Yeah, she was nominated. I don't think she won, did she?
No, she won.
She won. Oh, she did. Yeah, with Nomadland. That's what I was thinking, with Frances McDormand. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So that's going to be
Be pretty stunning. I mean, just visually based on the trailer. And again, trailers can be kind of notorious for showing you know, teasing some of the best looking stuff, some of the best lines in the movie. MCU is not known for that, honestly. The MCU trailers, they're really good at just giving you a little taste and save all the good stuff for the movie.
Yeah, they're also going somewhere that MCU hasn't really done. Is with visuals. I know a lot of the DC fans are, they're like, you know, specifically, like, you know, Snyder, how he uses color and all of that. And even, I almost called him Pony Smasher because that's his Twitter handle, David Sandberg and Shazam and the way they use the colors there. And then you watch Civil War and the big fight is in this airport and it's just gray. Like, there's no excitement visually to it. We finally got that. And that's why I think Infinity War and then Endgame are so great, as you have, and all the James Gunn and the Taika Waititi, these people are coming in and they're really expanding the palette.
Oh, yeah.
And this looks like it's going to do it as well.
Especially James Gunn. I mean, you can't debate. We recently rewatched the Guardians of the Galaxy films, and they're extremely colorful.
Yeah.
The first one especially, but yeah. Very visually stimulating.
You know what? One of the gigs that got James Gunn's foot in the door?
No.
He was a co-writer of the script to Zack Snyder's Dawn of the Dead.
Oh. So you may have mentioned that before.
Yeah.
Now that you say that. Okay.
But, so, that's the Eternals trailer. I would say we're on board. And after our next clip, we got to talk about, this is the week, we're going to be talking about Loki. So we'll be right back with that. So this is the week. This is the week that Loki drops, finally. I've seen apparently some, and where's our early viewings? I mean, we're the media. Right.
Yeah, no one contacted me.
People have seen the first two episodes. And they seemed pretty excited, and these are people that usually get excited about the same things as me, hearing a lot of the same things we heard with Falcon and Winter. So they said, I heard one person say, this is the most of all the Disney Plus Marvel shows so far. This one, just the two first episodes, has the most movie feel of all of them.
Oh, this one?
And then a lot of stuff really? I've heard that, yeah.
Because we, you know, they kind of bragged about, and I agreed with the fact that Falcon and Winter Soldier had a very cinematic arc and feel to the whole thing. Just like watching a 6-hour, 7-hour long movie.
Yeah, I think this is going to be the one with the special effects, though. This is going to be pretty crazy.
We don't know a whole lot about the plot, other than I think we're going to get some more deeper elements of multiverse, time travel, reality, sort of altering, timeline shaping, right? Because essentially, what we do know from the...
Yeah, they're really going to bring in the multiverse.
And what we know from the trailer is that Owen Wilson's character is essentially a time cop, right? He's the guy from the DC show on CW. The Time Police.
Oh. I wanted to almost say, Rory. Yeah, yeah.
He was Rory on Doctor Who.
Wasn't that Doctor his name in Doctor Who as well?
Like the 11th
Him and
Doctor.
Amy Pond.
Right. Well, I'm just chomping at the bit. I mean, I don't know what
I've heard
to say.
Good things about these two as well. It's like a buddy cop.
Right.
The detective. Detectives Through Time is how a couple people have did. They can't say much because the embargo doesn't lift until noon on Tuesday.
Oh, what about the review plot and plot elements and things like that?
Yeah, well, they can't give it. They can just say whether they liked it or not, like give a quick impression, but they can't like give an actual review until Tuesday. So, which I will be ignoring until I see the first episode. Are they dropping one episode or two on the first week? I know sometimes they like to do two. And I felt like they really should have done that with Falcon and the Winter Soldier because that first episode was good, but the second episode's when it kicked into gear.
I am looking at the release schedule here. I mean, I'm looking at both IMDb and Disney Plus, and it looks like it's just one. We're getting one episode on the 9th, and then episode 2's due out the 16th.
That's Wednesday. My brain was telling me that was Friday.
I thought it was Friday. It is Wednesday. Is it not? It is.
Holy crap.
Holy crap. It's even better news.
Yeah. Loki on Wednesday? That sounds great. Yeah.
So, I wanted to look and
they have some interesting multiverse questions. And I read an article on this, or someone, it was a Twitter thread, I can't remember. But someone was talking, Steve Rogers broke the rules as bad as Loki.
Yep. Definitely.
Steve Rogers failed in his mission, because when he went back in time, he created another timeline, and now everyone's asking the question, how did he jump from that timeline to the prime timeline, or were we even seeing the prime timeline at the end, or was that just a plot hole?
Yeah, I think I've said this before, you'll hurt yourself trying to square the plot threads with something that is, according to physics, as far as we know, impossible. Right? So,
it
works because it was in the script. That's how it was written. So, at least the way that I
don't know. They might have been trying to say something.
So what's funny about that is Banner Hulk, right? Dr. Hulk was actually trying to point this out to them while they were developing the quantum device so that they could do the time heist in Endgame, which is that, you know, Steve has traveled back in what is our past, but that's his future. And so everything that Steve did in his entire life, all of that stuff, it all happened, right? And he's still moving.
But he ended up being
wrong. He's still moving in a straight line, and supposedly all he did was return all of the artifacts to, you know, a second and a half after they were borrowed.
Right. But remember, he said that was before they did the time heist. When they did the time heist, he specifically went to meet the Ancient One, and the Ancient One was like, no. If you do this and you do this, it's going to split off, and it's going to split off, and it's going to create all these other timelines. And he was like, oh, well, we'll bring it back. And she's like, and I think she went, when it wasn't until he mentioned that Stephen Strange had told them this, then she was like, oh, okay. But she probably had to, but I still think there's no way that Captain America going back
didn't screw something up.
Didn't spring a new timeline.
I'm not disagreeing. I think that's entirely possible.
And maybe they'll mention him in this. Oh, and that was actually something clever I forgot to mention from the Eternals trailer. They refer to him as Captain Rogers instead of Captain America, because Captain America is not gone. There's a current Captain America. But yeah, so this Loki thing, they have so much they can dive into. I don't feel like it's going to be a week by week of a specific thread. I've heard they jump back to the 60s and the early 2000s and just all over time. And
well, I was going to say this, and I'm interested anymore in knowing a little more about directors, because there are many TV shows where, you know, the scripting, the writers, the week by week, you've got characters and plot threads that are contiguous, right? Things that have to develop over the course of a season, but they use a different director in various episodes, even literally for each episode. Episode to episode uses a different director. And
well, that's just like regular.
And
yeah,
frankly, when that happens, I don't think the show maintains a cinematic tone, which is what we were just talking about. And there was a single director so far for at least Falcon.
Well, it depends on the showrunner. Think about The Mandalorian.
Loki is directed, the entire show is being directed by this Kate Herron. Same director for all the shows. She's worked on a bunch of shows. Looks like her resume is mostly TV. I don't know that much about her. But she has worked on a lot of very successful TV shows. I just think that's good from a continuity standpoint to give it this cinematic feel where you feel like you're, you know, sort of marathoning. You could watch the whole thing from start to finish after the whole thing gets released, like Falcon and Winter Soldier, and it'll feel like...
How many episodes is this one?
7 or 8. Let me see. We know 6.
And they spend like, what, 15 to 25 million on each episode?
Let's hope. I don't know anything about budget.
Because here's what I got to say about it. With the technology now, and then they have those LED rooms that we talked about. I can never remember what it's called. These big LED rooms they used to film The Mandalorian, so they didn't have to. They could literally the actors could interact with their environment because they would see it. And so you heard that, and this is a tangent. Prepare tangent. That Warner Brothers, AT&T is, in a manner of speaking, dumping them off on Discovery. So that's it for AT&T, and it'll be Warner Brothers Discovery. And the point being is that means hopefully new leadership because they're in an awful. I mean, you know how much talent they've lost. It's highly unlikely if things stay the way they are that Christopher Nolan's going to work with them again. Patty Jenkins is directing her Star Wars Rogue Squadron movie. Villain, the guy who directed Dune, Dennis, he's pretty mad about the, Dune being dropped on streaming the same day as theaters.
Oh, is it?
Still, yeah.
But, I didn't realize that.
And that investigation thing, they still, DC, well, yeah, Warner has still not apologized.
Which platform?
For...
Who's going to air that?
HBO
it's
Max.
HBO Max is doing it?
It's That's just right. like King
okay.
Kong.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I was looking up the info on it, and I just now realized that
Rebecca Ferguson... I don't know which one comes out first, Dune or Black Widow, but I will probably definitely
I just realized
that.
Anyway, Rebecca Ferguson that's going to be in Dune playing Lady Jessica is the actress that we saw in the Mission Impossible films. And I can't remember seeing her in anything else.
Oh, yeah.
That's right, folks. We're changing the name of the podcast to Tangent. Tangents. Which yes. Jess has got. So, please, Tangents. Continue. Loki. Warner.
Well, my tangent was...
AT&T.
Marvel has now dropped 3 series. 5, if you count the 2 seasons of Mandalorian, spending between $15 and $30 million an episode. Yeah. And they're getting all the viewership numbers, and Warner Brothers refuses, and this is my one Restore the Snyderverse moment. Warner Brothers still refuses to give the numbers for Zack Snyder's Justice League. And we know it's huge because it's other places have given the numbers. It's been number one in the United Kingdom, the number one streaming movie in the United Kingdom for like a month and a half now. So it's definitely probably the most streamed thing on HBO Max. Warner refuses that. Toby Emmerich personally hates Zack Snyder. We were talking about that in the last episode with the politics. But if they gave Zack Snyder $20 million an episode to do 2 6 episode seasons to wrap out his story arc, it would probably be the biggest thing on television. I mean, honestly, other than Star Wars, is there a bigger
franchise,
IP, the DC Comics, than the Trinity? So that's it. And Loki, it just every Marvel show, we've often talked about for us, it's not Marvel versus DC. And I even have to specify nowadays, if you go on Twitter, you would be amazed how much DC fans hate each other. It's almost worse than Star Wars.
What? You mean DC and Marvel
God,
fans?
The vitriol against Shazam. Oh. No. I'm talking like, how about Batfleck versus Pattinson fans? Okay. The Ben Affleck versus Robert Pattinson fans. It's almost worse than the Marvel thing. It's mind-boggling. Yeah. So, every time Marvel comes out with something, we get to get all excited about that. And I'm like, you know what would be awesome? Is if it would be back in the days when they first, the Nolan trilogy wrapped up, they got Zack Snyder and did Man of Steel. And then they did Batman v Superman. And holy crap, there's the Trinity right there. And we're going to do all these movies. We're going to do a Cyborg movie. Nope, no more. We're going to do a Green Lantern Corps. We're going to do all this stuff.
Flash.
The Flash movie that's finally, like 7 years later, going to come out. But anyway, so enough of that tangent. We will definitely be talking at length about Loki in the next episode.
Indeed.
pretty excited for this. We got a little, some little tidbits. They've been filming Shazam and the Shazam Fury of the Gods. And Zachary Levy's back in Shazam shape. I think he's even in better shape this time than he was in the first one from the pictures that we'll get to in a second. You had unofficial drops this last week and one official one from the very hilarious director, David Sandberg. We'll start with that. Let's start with this tweezer. We'll start with this teaser. Let's watch this real quick. It's really
tweeted teaser.
Yeah. Yeah. Did I just invent something? Cool. It's loud.
Loud. Kaboom. Somebody needs to take the kettle off the stove.
Why is it so dark? Oh. Probably would have been a good idea to have like one light on.
So, right. That's pretty classic Shazam. That was a... and yeah, I think he put that out in response to the fact that someone got a pretty good set photo of the new suit. And I'm going to tell you about this suit. It's awesome. The cape, I see that. I guess that's going to be a CGI cape. I know Zach loves CGI capes, so they're so good at them nowadays. But the suit looks less padded than the other one. It's got more little details on it. Those bracers look cool. I don't remember if he had the
bracers. Yeah, I agree.
Bracers,
the bracers
like
in the belt.
Yeah. The lightning bolt they didn't look smaller. Like the director said it will glow. But this image is covering up. So what we got going
these
on.
Little... Well, they look like little... Almost like reflective tape or something you'd see on a cyclist or someone. You get these little kind of silvery looking pieces on there. And they don't look functional. And I just hypothesize that maybe they have something to do with motion capture.
Maybe.
Or maybe that's it's something that helps them in post-production to go in and add some kind of CGI effects. Maybe it has something to do with lightning running around over his body or something. I don't know.
Maybe he got shot
six times.
They just
look kind of awkward.
Yeah, I bet that it's one of those things also when that it's photographed without the lighting and stuff. And I remember when we got the first pictures of the work on the black suit Superman, his cape looked gray. It took a while for the color grading to fix that. But I'm going to move this image out of the way now so we can touch. So it's very early. There's been a lot of casting. I almost said we get Supergirl in this, but this is not the one. We get Supergirl in The Flash. But in this one, the villain are going to be gods. And Helen Mirren is playing the main villain. And,
I didn't realize that. Hespera?
Yes.
Lucy Liu's Calypso.
Lucy Liu, thank you. And, it turns out that they're not doing the hinted at post-credits scene with Mr. Mind. They decided to go with him dealing with, I guess furious gods. So that should be interesting. But yeah, all this dropped like a couple days ago, and it's been pretty cool that he just. The first comments I saw is like he definitely does not look like he's wearing padding this time.
Maybe
they made it very lumpy.
I'm still curious to know. If you know anything about, is there any conceivable connection between this film and the Black Adam?
Well, here's what they've been saying.
Because there should be.
Right. Well, I mean, Black Adam, they originally thought about introducing Black Adam in Shazam 2. But both Sandberg and Dwayne Johnson agreed that Black Adam needed his own film separate. And Shazam really needs... Right. Unlike Doctor Strange, who apparently, between the movie Doctor Strange and Infinity War, became the true master sorcerer, from abusing the Time Stone. Shazam has not had that time. He is not ready to face Black Adam yet. Right. So the prevailing hypothesis and what Dwayne Johnson wants to do and what David Sandberg would like to do is... The Shazam versus Black Adam would be the third Shazam movie.
Right.
And because he's got to be. I mean, and it probably, and they're really trying to push to get. I am certain that Dwayne Johnson wants Henry Cavill, if not in Black Adam. By the way, Henry Cavill was on a plane for the U.S. this weekend, so could be for anything. We know it's not for either of his any of his show. All his shows are filmed in England, so none of those. But yeah, The Rock and Henry Cavill have the same agent, so I wouldn't be surprised if they could get him back in the tights. Yeah. The question is,
that'd be cool.
Would they use the black or the blue?
Right. Because he was supposed to be in that post-credit scene.
Yeah.
Of the first one.
Couldn't,
right? And it was...
He couldn't make it because he was filming The Witcher.
It was a body double.
Yeah, it was right? also...
Basically
yeah,
someone in the suit.
I think it was actually his stuntman from... Like Henry Cavill's right. stunt double from back in the day.
That would make sense.
But...
Okay. Well, we don't really know anything else about the film at this point.
No,
but
that they're working
anxious
on it.
To see how that plays out. I mean, mostly, it's the I know I've said this before. Sorry, folks. MCU, what they have done extremely well is to stitch together this amazing quilt of continuity in between all of these different films. And I feel like as I am a DC fan, I'm a fan of all, you know, just comic sci-fi stories, mm-hmm. love good stories and love these characters. And when I think about what has happened with the DC IPs and these characters with the films, that's what I'm craving. I want to see some cross continuity. I want to see some contact and at the very least,
well,
the stories from these films to intersect at some point. And so at the very least, if they can do that with, you know, Shazam, Black Adam, and even Man of Steel, bring Henry Cavill into the picture.
Yeah, well,
I think that would
definitely
be very satisfying.
You look at did you see this? The director of The Flash dropped a picture.
No.
From the set. You recognize that? There's blood on it. Which is actually very Watchmen-esque, but that is the Batman Returns bat suit.
Oh! Right.
So Michael Keaton's okay. going to be dressing up, but...
I can't wait for that.
Yeah, I guess the word on the street is that the continuity of that Flash movie is going to be the Snyderverse. Mm-hmm. And Shazam, I had no trouble... I mean, except that he didn't know about the black suit. I have no trouble believing that that continuity is also there. He made that movie in a world where the Justice League exists. I mean, they talked about it at length in that. That movie is the most connected of all of the movies,
yes.
even more than Wonder Woman.
Yep.
Wonder Woman 1984 did not feel as connected to me.
No.
But that's fine. Mostly just because of the very warped things that would have happened to poor Bruce Wayne as a teenager. Can you see, you know, his right. wish would have been to have his parents back. I would be shocked if Sandberg, if they do it, to me, do your story. I'm all for director's freedom. Do your story. You don't have to explicitly do all the stuff they did in Shazam. It was nice. There's even a post-credit scene where they're making fun of Aquaman and he shows up or something. Jason Momoa, I think it was in extras. But, yeah, do that, but don't explicitly do something to exclude yourself from the universe. And that, I mean, it's not as good, you know, not as much fun as the MCU, but at least it's still... something where in my head canon I can be like, yeah, this is totally the same world.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my thing with that. I'm very excited for Shazam and The Flash. I know there's some people that have decided that they hate Warner Brothers so much they're not going to watch any of these other movies, but I am a Zack Snyder fan because of DC, not the other way around.
Right.
So That's the Shazam, and next we're going to. I'm gonna hit the.
Say a few words.
Yeah,
mourning. Yeah. I'm gonna say a few words in mourning.
All right, here,
out of respect for Jupiter's Legacy. Originally a graphic novel, right? A storyline. It's written by Mark Miller, and I believe it was published on Image. Yeah, it was Image Comics. And to be completely forthcoming here, never read the books, never read the comic. I want to now, because I have a pretty good feeling that the source material, like most things, probably way better than a film or television show adaptation, right? I mean, I think just about anyone is going to agree with that statement.
Yeah.
The book is always better than the film or the TV show.
Lord of the Rings being a possible exception, and the movie is just as good as the book.
Yeah.
The extended ones.
I don't know.
Unless you just really love yourself some Tom Bombadil. But anyway.
Right. Well, picked up by Netflix, produced one season, and was supposed to be multiple seasons because the story is a generation-spanning story, and I could tell from the very beginning this is going to be a very long-winded, not necessarily in a bad way, but I could tell from the very start, like, it's going to take some time for them to tease all of this apart, and you've got some characters who you're seeing in present day who have some deep history, right? Most of them are family. At the very least, they've been friends for something like 100 years. And I'm just going to, you know, apologies. There's sort of mild spoilers here for people who haven't seen the show. If it's on your list and you still want to watch it, maybe you want to pause the podcast now and go watch it. Mild spoiler, not a complete spoiler, but the show got canceled. Not difficult to understand why when you watch the show. They just held way too much back as far as there being this. It almost feels like a facade of there being this very deep kind of involved story and a lot of complexity to these characters. But all you ever get are these little hints and tidbits and these flashbacks where it's just questions after question after question. Well, how does he get that? Well, how did they do that? Well, where did they get their powers from? And what is that? What was that thing? And how did they get the... Nothing gets answered at all in the first season.
See, this is the kind of spoiler I like.
Yeah.
Because I have heard that there was a show HBO had back way back in their heyday when The Sopranos and Deadwood and all that, and they had a show called Carnival.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, that looks awesome. And then it got canceled after the first season, and everyone said it was canceled on a big cliffhanger. To this day, I have never watched that. I was like, I don't want to experience that. I still don't know why I went back and watched freaking Firefly after Serenity. I was like, whoa. And well, now it's even more shocking. It's like, whoa, it came from that asshat?
Yeah. It would be a little bit like... And, we've got this grand plan to do another book club, sort of a two-part episode where we're going to read The Watchmen, talk about the book, and then do, like, a blow-by-blow, talk about the film. But it'd be a little bit like if you, you know, read The Watchmen and then someone produced a TV show based on the first quarter of the comic book and didn't tell you anything about Rorschach, or where Dr. Manhattan came from, or got his powers, anything about the group, you know, the earlier group that formed up, you know, back in like the 40s, 50s, 60s, right? The sort of precursor to the modern day heroes. All you got with these heroes. Little flashbacks where you saw, hey, that was a thing, apparently. Back in the 30s and the 40s, and apparently these people knew each other back then, and apparently they became a superhero team together, and that's all you get. That's it.
Yeah,
and it you do get to so... see you do get to see the story arc of the main character, this guy, the Utopian. And again, you get to see him go through this sort of insanity, and some kind of power is reaching out to him and it's calling to him, and he has these visions. And so he has to gather these specific people together, and they go and they find this magic island. And again, that's the thing. You do get to see how these people apparently are gifted with superpowers, but you don't learn much about it. Is it aliens? Is it
right?
Is it magic? Is this some kind of ancient artifact? Is it they walk through some kind of gateway, and it appears that they are walking across the surface of one of Jupiter's moons. And it's literally the only time in the show that you get any clue as to why it's called Jupiter's Legacy.
You saw the Legacy Watchmen TV series, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Where Ozymandias was trapped on Europa or something like
that. It was awesome. It was hilarious. Yeah, there were some very good things about that show, and there was a lot of kind of head scratching moments in that show, the Watchmen show that they produced on HBO. It wasn't bad. It's not that I didn't enjoy it. There was some elements of it that I just,
you know what I love most about the Watchmen universe, which I had never thought about? There's only one person with superpowers in that whole universe.
Yep.
Only Dr. Manhattan has powers.
That's right.
And he is a god.
He's incredibly flawed, right? That's one of the major, it's his spoiler for our upcoming Watchmen. Yeah, well, he begins to lose his humanity. And that's I think the point that he was trying to make with that story is that for someone who has godlike powers, you're going to begin to lose touch with what makes us human. Right. Mm-hmm. If you're immortal and in a sense sort of omnipresent or omniscient or clairvoyant, and if you've got these, you can manipulate and alter reality in a way that just doesn't jive with our perception of it. If you can see the way that the universe works on a quantum level, then you begin to disabuse yourself of notions that make us human.
Right.
Which is what happens.
We'll talk a lot about that, I'm sure. That one we'll definitely have to figure out a way to break up our various conversations.
Yeah. So, Jupiter's Legacy, I'm not saying you should just completely avoid it. If you're out of things to watch, if you're in a show hole, right, and you're just looking for something, it was well produced. The acting is okay. I get the sense that the actors did the best they could with what they had, but the writing suffers in several places. Because again, you've got these scenes where you feel like, what's motivating everyone? Not real sure what's going on right now, but okay, he seems to be upset, and this guy's arguing with him, so maybe there's some history there. I don't know, because they won't tell us. So, anyway.
Netflix, that's interesting for Netflix, because Army of the Dead is an absolute smash for them. So
yeah, well, again, just to be forthcoming, it's my understanding that they had a grander vision for the show, and it seems like I read that Mark Miller originally wanted to make a film out of this.
He's kind of a jerk.
Was it James Gunn?
Yeah, we heard that.
One of the Marvel directors basically convinced him, says, you don't need to make this a movie. There's too much here. You need to turn it into a show, put it on a streaming network, do something like that with it so you can really tell this story. So you definitely get the sense that this first season was kind of like a teaser for what was going to be 3 or 4 seasons worth of story. Mm-hmm. And they just, I think they fumbled the ball with the first season. Did not give you nearly enough meat, it didn't give you nearly enough that you could sink your teeth into to keep people's interest.
I think that was and if you look at the long form things, you always got to do that, like with The Mandalorian in the first episode, it has all this stuff happening, and then there's Grogu at the end. One episode, everything is there.
Yep.
you know, and then you're there for the haul. The Justice League, the Zack Snyder Justice League starts off with the much like he did in BVS with the a recap of the end of the last movie. Mm-hmm. But then it almost immediately gets to some action. You see what everyone's doing, how it's affected the world, but it's not like a long, drawn-out, like, dialogue-ridden. It's like, oh, well, Wonder Woman's trying to be Superman, the Amazons are guarding this thing, these things are waking up, and all of this, and then you get a big action sequence within 20 minutes. And then it does all that. It still manages probably as much character building as that.
Yeah.
So,
you know,
well, that's a shame that, I mean, I feel bad for the actors and stuff. Miller is kind of a
jerk, a legend.
Just judging by his tweet. Well, yeah, he's that, but that doesn't...
Yeah.
This is people named Miller. Frank Miller's also kind of an ass. relation. So let's, after I hit the pause button in a minute, let's... I'm going to edit all that out. Nah. I don't think it's funny. We talk about this Invincible that I finally watched, that you finally got me to watch, and I finished it. And this is one that is definitely going to be continuing.
So, yeah, absolutely.
Another Image.
Yeah, interesting. A little continuity for us here. Also an Image Comics title.
Oh, okay. So we're going to talk about Invincible that was recommended to me. And when I saw the trailer for it, I was like, yeah, that might be something. I mean, it was Robert Kirkman, but I didn't know what I was getting into. Boy, after that first episode, I was like, well, that's pretty cool. You know, it's kind of a father-dad superhero. Then the end of that episode, I'm like, oh!
Yeah.
So I'm just going to go ahead and say, this has been over for some weeks now. This is one of our patented spoiler-heavy discussions.
Spoiler-heavy discussion, that's right. Yeah.
Tangents probably included, because there's definitely some... The one thing I want to say with this Jupiter's Legacy and Invincible and the newer Watchmen, the dark side of superheroism, as much as people try to make us think that Snyder's stuff has
the
been
boys,
shit.
Right.
Yeah. The boys, all of this stuff and all the hate for BVS tells me that maybe the haters are a silent minority or a vocal minority, because look at all of this that has come from since the Watchmen and Batman v Superman. You know, you've got the superheroes with the angst and the problems and all of that.
And frankly, if you take a look back at the MCU shows created and that aired on Netflix, I mean, Daredevil, Luke Cage, the Punisher, right? Jessica Jones, the whole Defenders cast. I mean, obviously, the Punisher, no one was under the illusion that that was going to be PG-13, right? It's the Punisher, right? It was very bloody.
That's why the Punisher kept failing, as they kept trying to...
Yeah, well, I mean, even with Daredevil and Luke Cage and occasionally Jessica Jones, but mostly with Daredevil and a few times with Luke Cage, he definitely had some violence. There's some people getting, you know, things broken, things relocated that shouldn't get relocated, right? Body parts.
This might actually be more violent than The Boys. I think Invincible may take the cake.
It's possible.
And it's a cartoon.
Because it's animated, and they can do some things in animation that just from a special effects and CGI and things like that with live-action filming would cost a lot more in production. And that's saying something. I mean, The Boys was pretty graphic. There were definitely some moments in The Boys where it was just...
I am so excited for the next season.
Jensen
Ackles is going to be playing their Captain America called Soldier Man or something like that.
Okay.
And he's probably going to be pretty warped. So
it's
like anytime they introduce a new hero, it's in quotes, except for...
Right.
I almost said Adam Eve. Adam Eve is from Invincible. the girl.
Yep.
But, so this really sets up this universe. Now, this is exactly what Jupiter's Legacy, from what you told me, didn't do. This There is no universe that existed before this. It set up everything. You had a very Justice League type group of heroes for all of one episode. And you have Omega Man, who is very clearly supposed to be some sort of Superman, but he's settled down with his...
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah, he's he claims to be an alien from another world sent out to be heroic. And we all know how that turns out.
Of course.
He has a child who it turns out is also a Daxamite. Is that what it was?
Omni-Man. Sorry, not Omega Man.
Omni-Man.
Yeah. I think we were talking about the head of the team that you mentioned at the beginning. And yeah, I've already forgotten the name of the leader at that first team. The first team who comes back is sort of a zombie.
Oh yeah,
in the last episode,
he gets his. He gets his head ripped off, and then they put it back on, and then he's so mad, he goes crazy, and then dude, like, rips him in half, and I get the feeling that's going to be like a running gag, and he's going to keep coming back until he's just finally a cyborg.
If you haven't looked, take a real good look at the voice cast for this show. Recommend you do that. For anybody listening, because it's really expansive, it's
exceptional.
Right? Got everyone: John Hamm, Seth Rogen, Mark Hamill,
Seth
Clancy
Rogen
Brown,
the cheesy Green Lantern, except there's like Green Lantern bureaucracy that like checks on all the planets to see how their superheroes handle alien invasions.
It's hysterical. Obviously, J.K. Simmons is the voice of the dad, Omni-Man. Stephen Yeun getting probably the first call there from Robert Kirkman, who everyone knows as Glenn from The Walking Dead, is the voice of the son, the title character.
Wow, always pictured with one of his eyes bulging out.
Right.
After getting Negan'd. That is straight from the comics, by the way. A lot of people are like, that was just overkill. It's like, that's exactly what happened in the comics. Like, frame for frame.
Well, this is you already mentioned this. There's a very idealized, black and white, good versus evil kind of morality archetype and stereotype, if I can say that, with comic books, right? There's a very clear morality. And I think the really good writers over time, right? If you want to talk about Frank Miller, you want to talk about, The Dark Knight Returns and different books through the years have occasionally tried to challenge that, right? I think this is something you get a lot with X-Men and
Batman.
In the army, right? Batman, obviously, although still, Batman is still one of these characters that has he's got lines he won't cross, period, end of story. And so you definitely get this kind of black and white morality, and this is one of many stories, like The Boys, and like we were just talking about even with Dr. Manhattan, in The Watchmen, again, Frank Miller, another really good case where you're questioning these stereotypes, and when you get people in power who are essentially pitted against forces that they're outgunned, outnumbered, the people forced to make a decision between, like, what's the least bad thing I can do here for the greater good? Right. It's always that's the big sort of trope that keeps coming back in these situations. It was for the greater good, right? I'm going to bend my own morality, and I'm going to sacrifice my own moral standing so that everybody else can sleep at night, right?
Yeah,
so nobody else has to.
Yeah, something Snyder said often that these do, The Boys and Invincible and all the things you're talking about, and especially in the Snyder movies, he's like he always found it stupid. Like, if a superhero throws someone against a wall, that it doesn't absolutely kill them.
Right.
And, you saw that. Wonder Woman threw dudes against the wall, and it splattered blood on the wall. Those dudes are dead.
Yes.
Although he would joke and say, that guy's fine. He got up right after this. He was fine.
Right.
And then the famously someone asked him about Batman killing, and he said, wake the fuck up. He's like, Batman would probably kill people. He's like, you don't drive the Batmobile, slam it into a car, and the person not die. Even in the Nolan movies, there were scenes where it's like, there is no way the person in that vehicle survived the Batmobile tank running it over. They're dead. But and then these take it to the next level. They really show you, like, the boys, almost the very first scene of the dude with his girlfriend. She steps off, and then the Flash guy, and he's left holding her stumps.
That's right.
And that's why also in Justice League, the Flash, whenever he's doing something in super speed, when he's saving Iris, it's all very slow. Because if he tried to just run up at super speed and jerk her down out of the way, it would rip her to shreds. So this, they bring all of the violence is what you would expect from super-powered individuals.
Right. And they're real people. And I think that was the big kind of central point that the boys is trying to make, is that, you know, if the world had actual super-powered individuals, if somebody just snapped their fingers and all of a sudden you had a handful of people around the globe who were just somehow granted superhuman powers, what are the odds that they're going to be Clark Kent? Right? This sort of, you know, corn-fed, you know, sort of Bible Belt, conservative, moral, upstanding, good moral fiber, right? This kind of nice guy from Kansas, pretty slim, right? You're going to end up with people who at best are doing the best they can with what they've got, but they're going to make some bad calls. They're definitely going to make some bad decisions, and they're going to get manipulated by people who are corrupt.
Just to say the majority of them are even going to be good.
Right, and that's what I was going to say. You know, and is at worst, you're going to end up with a whole lot of essentially supervillains.
More of the heroes in Invincible are at least somewhat heroic, if not jerks. But
well, they're real still people. Heroic. That's right. And that's
whereas
all I was
in the
say.
Boys, you it seems all, like almost all of them are bad,
corrupt. You get all points in between, though, right? You get some heroes that are maybe more self-involved. They're going to make the right call when push comes to shove. They'll throw in the
still
fight.
Clear on the robot.
Yeah, well,
he was a robot.
Yeah.
But that whole thing was creepy. The whole robot side story caught me off guard.
First, he was an artificial intelligence. Here's what I took away from that. Now, I might be missing something. And this is another one of those where I read first several of the book. I want to say I maybe read 9, 10, 11 issues, something like that. And that had been a few years ago. And so I didn't remember a whole lot about the story, but I'd like to read more of it. But what I took away from the robot story was he's an artificial intelligence who became self-aware, right? A true AI, and decided to, again, here's one of these kind of moral loopholes, decided to hire or to kind of swindle, in a way, these villains who were this, you know, guy making clones of himself and using his genetic technology to make himself a body.
I love that.
With stolen DNA, right, from the guy who's, what's his name, Rexplode. It's Jason Mantzoukas' character, who's hysterical. I can't see that guy, that actor, and not think of his character from The Good Place, which is hilarious.
I love that actor. He's so funny. He's, the Brooklyn Nine-Nine, too.
Yeah. And so he makes himself a body, and I think he kind of falls in love with the monster girl, right? And kind of feels bad for the fact that she's trapped in, you know, and she's like getting younger.
Reverse aging.
Yeah. And so it's like he wants to be with her in a way, or at least, you know, it's like a Pinocchio story, I guess, if you want to look at it like that. He wants to be a real boy.
That's what I was thinking too.
So, I don't think and that's Zachary Quinto, by the way. Siler, aka Spock, aka What else have we seen him in? No, those are the two big things I always remember about that actor. Mm-hmm. He was Siler in the show Heroes, which was a great show. One of those I've been wanting to go back and watch again. And obviously,
I did finally finish that. It was a fairly satisfying, if not cliche, boring ending. It wasn't anything as... It just put itself in the box. We could talk about that someday.
Yeah, that was a show that had a stellar season one, and then immediately that writer's strike happened.
Yeah.
This was back like 2004, 2005, and the show suffered because of that, because they brought other writers in, and they started to try to develop the show in other directions, and it just really, it stumbled a lot as it went.
Yeah.
Anywho.
So, once they probably shouldn't have killed Isaac, the painter guy.
Right?
That kind of messed
the junkie
up. Yeah.
Well, Invincible.
I mean, then Siler was... But anyway, yeah, Invincible. And so and we've already said spoilers. So that first episode, it goes exactly as I thought. You know, it's the father and the son, and the son finally gets his powers, and he's teaching him. And then the credits roll, but then it's like... Then it has this scene, and he shows up at the, I don't know what they called their superhero team, their little Justice League Avengers-type team.
Right.
And he just kills them all.
Yeah.
So that sets it up. And what we're in for is he's not who he says he is. And then after a while, they give us the his true backstory, that the Daxamites are villains. And the last two episodes, I mean, you get this teen team that we thought he was going to be on, Invincible. Oh, and I love the way they do the credits, the opening credits. It's always like, I'm, and then they show the title card.
Yeah, and it gets bloodier and bloodier.
Yes. Yeah, which was great foreshadowing.
Yes.
So they're not impervious, but apparently the Daxamite blood won't die. That's what they, the guy with the messed up face that's kind of like their Nick Fury type.
Oh, yeah.
They got some of the blood from Invincible after he got impaled by the lion villain guy, which that guy seems really powerful, and he's just somewhere else right now.
Right.
So they got some of his blood. They're trying to figure out how to kill Omni-Man, because they've known about Omni-Man. So here are my questions about... And I'm assuming we're getting more of this, because I think this was a pretty big hit for them.
Yeah.
Yeah,
season two is
the big question is, where did Omni-Man go off to?
Exactly.
Because I feel like he PO'd. Is he coming back with... I don't think he could go back
home? Yeah, I don't know.
No, he can't go back home, because he'll... They'll kill him, because that would be the weakness. The lion guy, that's minor, but that seemed like he was the most powerful thing... He was
Battle
the one that
Beast.
Really took...
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was Michael Dorn, another Star Trek connection.
Oh, yeah, that's nice. And then you had this love triangle with the Invincible and Atom Eve and his girlfriend from high school. And that was actually pretty interesting. But the real big thing is, what's going to go on with this? This is... That whole, like, you knew they were going to come to blows. And... at that point, when that's happening right there, I'm like, how are they gonna, how does this work itself out? Because it just feels like Omni-Man has, like we talked about with Manhattan, is lost, was never.
He was never human to begin with.
Right.
You're right. It becomes apparent there at the end, because I'll be honest, up until the end of that last episode, I just kept wondering what his motivation was. Yes, like, what is it exactly, you know, is it, okay, he was essentially just trying to create a son, or a child, you know, or a daughter, but just wanted to have an offspring.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, doesn't really give two flips about humanity.
Right.
Right, he just wanted to have a kid, and as it turns out, he's, you know, huge disappointment to him, he beats him to a pulp, and so...
And then gets that flashback... And then gets this, like, dose of humanity out of nowhere.
Right.
Remembering the baseball game or whatever with his pet. I mean, his wife, who we referred to as a pet. Yeah. And then they made her hear all that. That was cold.
I think one of the kind of fun treats about this, and it's funny, it reminded me a little bit of, a long time ago playing games like City of Heroes and different comic franchises and stuff. So you get people like Omni-Man, and where you get this real stereotypical power set. And I'm not entirely sure, like, why is it, invulnerability, super strength, flight, laser eyes, right? This sort of Superman power set seems to be such a standard. But what I really like are a really creative variety of, especially in the villains in the show, the heroes as well, right? That you see some power sets and some concepts and characters that aren't often explored. At least the whole idea.
I will say
Monster
this
Girl.
About flight and invulnerability, or at least some sort of damage resistance. You can't have flight without that.
True.
Landing
unless
would
it
be
depends
for
on
a
the
human
nature
body.
Of flight. That's right. What show or comic was it? So people who can fly through some sort of generation of an energy field, or if you're telekinetic. Right, I think that's the ultimate manifestation of telekinesis, right? As if there was a found footage film. I'm gonna forget the name of it, where three high school kids find some kind of meteor in the ground and it grants them telekinetic powers, and by the end of the film two of them learn how to, use their powers well enough that they can do this, and they can essentially use, telekinesis to, throw their own body. You project themselves through the air like a projectile, right? And they can fly essentially with it, and you can create a bubble, right? If you can create a bubble of force around yourself so that it's just like sitting in a room, bubble around yourself.
That would make sense
so
that too.
You just create a sort
I know
of
some of the X-Men
field
can
yourself.
Randomly fly in some comics, but like Magneto, he's not going to be zooming around like Superman, because if
well,
he
see,
hits the ground,
you see him
he's
do that
break.
A lot in the show, movies, animated shows, even comics and stuff, and he's always levitating. And I just always have to ask the question: is his suit
gotta be
lined
metal around.
With metal? Does he wear a harness under his?
Well, no,
how does he
fly? There's metal in
how
the ground.
Fly?
He uses
yeah,
the
but
metal
I mean, his,
in the ground
to do what?
To a magnet, the opposite instead of.
Yeah, but there has to be something conductive in his suit. That's the point. Unless he's pushing against the metal in his blood, right? Which seems really painful. You wouldn't want to do that.
Right.
But these are the kinds of things that comics and comic books start. If you really explored someone's power set to its sort of logical conclusion, Magneto should be able to throw lightning. People, it's
a well. They've done a very good feature. Job of explaining all of Superman's very strange powers from the comics.
It's radiation,
he is a solar battery.
Battery. That's right. No, I get that. There was at one point that we tangents, folks. Sorry. There was one point in the New 52 continuity before they rebooted it yet again, where he got essentially a new power, where it was related to his heat vision, but instead of coming out of his eyes, he could just detonate. Right. He could just. Cause like an explosion, which, if I'm not mistaken,
that drains him though.
Right.
He could drain all of his energy with the heat vision. That's why he doesn't just constantly go around using it. They also explored they explored it a lot in the Henry Cavill Superman.
That's right.
How he works with when he gets exploded by the nuke, then he sits in the sun and absorbs the sunlight. When he's in the atmosphere of Krypton, he has no powers, stuff like that.
Yep.
But there's one more thing I want to mention about Invincible. This particular scene, why I picked this image, has spawned some pretty funny memes. This is when he's like, "Think," he's giving him the big speech there. And my favorite has been, I clicked the wrong screen. This Batman with the just beaten to death by Joker Robin. So that's I love it, and that tells you that Invincible is definitely now in the zeitgeist, and hopefully it won't it won't be canceled. So we got one thing to talk about. This one will be spoiler free, so if you've been waiting to skip, this is when you will want to start the next.
Mm-hmm.
Pausing. Oh. So, I got to see Army of the Dead, but my co-host has not seen Army of the Dead yet, so this will be a spoiler-free chat. And, you know, for those that say Snyder doesn't like color, Army of the Dead will give you plenty of it, because it's set in Vegas. So, the spoiler-free version, the synopsis is that you... there was a zombie outbreak, but it was not worldwide. It started in Vegas and was contained. They built, you know, they got shipping containers and they built this big wall around it. So Vegas is like overrun. And the big thing I want to say about it is that this is different. You know, I know every zombie movie says that. This is a lot different than your standard zombie apocalypse fare. One, they're, the zombies, are organized. They seem to, they say the word zombie in the movie, which is something you notice a lot of movies will avoid because with your traditional slow moving zombie, it's always, it seems to be implied that for instance, in The Walking Dead, in that universe, there are no zombie movies. Because everyone seems to be making the same mistakes that if you'd ever seen a zombie movie, you would never make.
Of course.
Either that or everyone's deaf, partially deaf. Because they always stumble on these herds of zombies, right? It's like, oh, we're trapped in the middle of a bunch of herd of zombies. How could we not hear them coming? Mm. You know, so, yeah, they, you know, Zack Snyder loves the fast zombies. So these can run, they're smart, they have this society. But the big takeaway is that, I mean, they have a king and a queen. That's Zeus, and I want to say the queen's name is Athena. This is her here. And this is what we were talking about before we recorded. He used this old 60s lens called a dream lens, and it's, I don't know nothing about no photography, but it's some sort of big aperture. So what you get is this really intense depth of field. You see, like, literally her face has depth of field on it. And it's really creepy, and he uses it quite well throughout this entire movie. It's director of photography, executive producer, and he wrote it. So he did everything.
Hmm.
The big thing about this is, you know, you were talking about the acting in Jupiter's Legacy, and it got me thinking. I don't think I've ever seen bad acting in one of Snyder's movies. He always surrounds himself with some talent, and he's really good at finding talent as well, because the acting is exceptional. This is,
I was just looking at the cast. Yeah. You see Tig Notaro is pulled into this. Obviously Dave Bautista.
Yes. Everyone knows that. You heard about that, right? She was CGI'd in to replace that guy who was did some sexual assault charges or something. So Zach's like, you know what? Let's just wipe him from the film and completely replace him with Tig Notaro, which was apparently very expensive to do. And that was an upgrade. She is brilliant. Oh, my God. She absolutely steals the show.
Hiroyuki Sanada, who is long time, lot of sort of American, you know, American films that depict, you know, Japanese, he was Wolverine movies, Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
I mean, he's been in a lot of films, right? Mm-hmm. He was very briefly in Avengers Endgame as one of the leaders of the Hand that Hawkeye's hunting down. You see, he gets killed with a sword. Great actor, though. And I have no idea how significant a role he has in this movie. I'm just looking through the cast.
All right. So here's I've been thinking hard about a way to describe this movie. This movie is if the movie Aliens, the James Cameron one, were a zombie movie.
Okay. Yeah.
Very strong sci-fi element, and there's a possibility that what you're seeing is maybe not as cut and dry as you think, and there'll be one scene where he gets there. The German guy, I can't remember his name. He also steals the show. I keep clicking the wrong.
An actor in this that we saw in Luke Cage, Theo Rossi, or unless it's Rossi. That I don't remember seeing in anything else. I saw his picture. I knew he looked familiar. He was really good in Luke Cage.
Yes, he is. He is an ass in this movie. the guy that was in Garrett Dillahunt is also in this. He's the one that has the line in the trailer when they see the zombie tiger. He's like, oh. He's like, that's just not right. The zombie tiger is the CGI, as is usual for a Snyder film, is just absolutely flawless. And this picture I got here is that doesn't happen. That's just promo shot, but I have to point this out because this is hilarious. This movie was made before the Snyder Cut was even a thing. Like, he thought it would never see the light of day. So here in the vault, you will see those five cans. Those are the cans that they put film in for movie theaters. That's the Snyder Cut. That's supposed to be the Snyder Cut, hidden, locked away in this vault, in this casino in the middle of zombie-ridden Las Vegas. But, yeah, it's got a lot. You couldn't see the first 6 minutes, and I think that's just the song. But yeah, let's just say the sci-fi element is very strong. They tell you how the zombies start, and
right.
I don't know if you got that far, if you watched the first 10 minutes.
I watched about the first 10 minutes of it, and we had kiddos in the house, and I have to find a time to watch it after hours.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But so, yeah, if you saw that first 10 minutes, then you saw, like, when they're pulling out of Area 51... If you look really closely, you'll see three lights in the sky, and then that'll go. So this is the start of a franchise. We are next getting an anime prequel on Netflix. And they have also finished filming a live action prequel to this, featuring the German actor. I think his character's name's Dieter, which looks like Dieter when you see it spelled. But yeah, so. Yeah, I highly recommend this if you haven't seen it. I am usually not a horror movie guy, but this is a horror movie in the same way Aliens was a horror movie. So it's got some scary parts. It's got a whole lot of gore because it's a zombie movie, but on the same token, it's a fantastic action film. Lots of good practical effects. There's a Snyder getting himself in some interesting positions to get some crazy shots of zombies flying through the air and David Bautista shooting him with machine gun. And there's a really, the characters are really well done. I mean, it's not just a bloody action film. So anyway, so that's it for this week. Next week, we will be talking Loki for sure. I almost thought I said the wrong thing. Loki for sure. Okay. And I'm going to try and read The Watchmen this week if I can survive the heat here.
Right. So we'll do a Loki episode, and then we're going to dive into our Watchmen stuff and probably have shorter episodes as Loki comes out from week to week. So
that's a good idea.
Subscribe. Stay tuned.
Like us. Tell all your friends. And we'll see you next week.
Tell your mom. Tell your pa. Go on a tangent.
Yes, more tangents. That'll be the subtitle.